Now, the situation on the ground in Ukrainian and Russian war, the fighting keeps going on across the front lines, especially including the near Pokrovsk, where Russian advances have been slowed, but they are still grinding on. What are the decisive focal points in the war currently, in your point of view?
Well, three things for me. Number one, yes, Russia continues to grind on, but let's keep it in context. I mean, in the last 7 months, they've advanced about 50 kilometers. That's it, at the cost of tens of thousands of lives and hundreds of vehicles, artillery, et cetera. They don't care about the casualties that they have, but let's just keep in context where we are, and that after 10 and a half years of war, Ukraine still controls over 80% of the sovereign territory of Ukraine. So I think people complaining or worrying or wringing their hands about Russian advances should step back from the map a little bit and see what we're talking about. Secondly, I think this the Ukrainian counteroffensive that they launched in the direction of Kursk is also an indicator that Russian victory is not inevitable, that they're not unbeatable. And I think the general staff did a good job thinking about where they could take risks, where could they try and change the narrative, put pressure on the Kremlin. The third thing, of course, is the failure of the West to commit to helping Ukraine win. And it does sort of feel like the administration has This current administration has sort of packed it in, and I could be wrong. I hope I'm wrong, but it doesn't feel like there's any new significant help coming from the United States until we have a new president. I do anticipate that if the next administration is a Harris administration, we'll see an improvement in what the U.S. does for Ukraine.
So the situation on the ground very much depends on the international situation and what's the discussions in countries like the United States, of course, with the upcoming elections. Now, this weekend in Rammstein base, there's going to be another meeting, but this time with the heads of states. Zelensky is going to be there. U.S. President Joe Biden is going to be there. Other NATO leaders, they will present Ukraine's. Zelensky will present Ukraine's victory plan. He says specific steps for a just end of the war. From what is publicly known, how feasible is this plan in your mind? What are the chances for it to work?
Well, of course, we don't know what the plan is. I mean, there's only speculation about aspects of it. So I couldn't make any meaningful comment about the plan. But I do think that we should be very realistic that Russia will never live up to any agreement it makes. So if any plan that's based on the assumption that Russia will comply with the agreement, I think it's going to have a problem. And I also I'm very I think it's unhelpful that nations are putting pressure on Ukraine to go ahead and agree to give up some terrain when Ukraine is not losing the war. We are not helping them enough, and yet we're expecting Ukraine to go ahead and give up territory. And of course, it's not just any territory. We're talking about Crimea, which is essential, in my view, for Ukrainian reconstruction efforts, for Ukraine's economy. If Russia is allowed to keep Ukraine or Crimea, I think not only is that a terrible signal to send that, Putin's aggression is rewarded, it also will make it very difficult for Ukrainian reconstruction. And of course, the Chinese will see this as a sign of weakness by the West, a lack of political will. So President Zelensky knows what's in the best interest of his country, but the West needs to be thinking strategically about this war. What are the implications? What are the implications with China? The implications with the war against Iran? All of these things are connected.
Still, there's been, in recent months, ever more talk about peace talks, ceasefire talks. There's the victory plan for just peace, of course. Do you foresee, perhaps after the US elections or with the new president in the US, that there could be some movements in or around, or could there be any conditions for that, about for substantial talks about ceasefire or peace talks?
I don't know. Of course, it'll depend on who, if Vice President Harris is elected as president, who she brings as her team. If it's Trump, I have no confidence that he will do anything that's based on moral principles, only on trying to get a deal. But again, I don't understand why there's so much emphasis on trying to get a peace talks when we have not done everything we can to help Ukraine win. And I think European countries are going to regret if Russia is allowed, is rewarded for what they're doing, that you're going to see millions more refugees. You're going to see continued disruption of food and energy shipments out of Ukraine. I don't see the benefits for Europe other than to take the pressure off themselves of European countries for just a year or two. And then you and I are going to be talking about this again in a couple of years. So I'm really disappointed in the lack of political will we're seeing from the United States and Germany and some other Western countries.
Well, for alternatively, well, you need to give Ukraine what it needs to win the war on the ground, artillery, all kinds of arms. Well, this week I just read the news. There was F-16s from Netherlands have been confirmed to that they are being sent to Ukraine. But otherwise, it seems there's been lack of will as of recent months to keep up with the substantial support Ukraine from the West.
Yeah, there's a lack of urgency. I think people are just hoping that this will just problem will just go away. Bad luck for Ukraine, but that really means bad luck for Europe and bad luck for the United States because the Chinese are going to see that we do not have the political will, and I think that's a terrible signal. So, who knows? I don't know what'll come out of this Ramstein meeting. I hope I'm wrong on all this and that we'll see a massive breakthrough and new policies. But I don't anticipate that. And look, it's not just about providing weapons. We have not used all the economic tools. Russia is still getting billions of dollars from selling oil to China and India. We've done nothing to stop that. And I think it's because of concern about anything that affects gas prices in the United States right before an election. That's not inconsequential, but I mean, we have not used all of our economic tools to shut off the things that Russia needs to stay in this war.
And the conditions for Ukraine to win remain the same as about 2 years ago, probably.
Well, I mean, winning equals Ukraine reestablishing sovereignty over all of its territory, which would obviously include the Donbass and Crimea, and the accountability of Russian war crimes and Russia paying for the damage that's been done and getting these children back that have been kidnapped. These are the things. And then, of course, there's got to be some sort of a security guarantee for Ukraine. And that means NATO membership or at a minimum, U.S. troops, other troops on the ground in Ukraine.
The Middle East, you mentioned that briefly as well. Now, in the Middle East, seems that Israel has substantially weakened Iran's proxies, Hamas and Hezbollah, in recent months and especially weeks. Therefore, also, it seems that Iran's reach and influence in the region has been reduced and weakened. Iran being an ally with Russia, does this situation in the Middle East somehow affect the Kremlin and its calculations?
Yeah, as I said earlier, I think the war in the Middle East is connected to the war, Russia's war against Ukraine. Iran has no friends in the world except for Russia. Iran provides drones and ballistic missiles to Russia. Russia provides technology and other aid to Iran. So if Israel is able to continue diminishing Iranian capabilities, and it seems to me that Iran is not quite as strong and powerful as maybe we thought several months ago, then that would make it less, it would make it more difficult for Iran to provide certain aid for Russia. Meanwhile, if Ukraine defeats Russia, then Iran becomes more isolated and again makes it more difficult for them to support Hezbollah and Hamas and the Houthis. So, helping Ukraine here and helping Israel here helps us address two of the major problems that the world faces, the two of the causes of most of the instability and terrorism in much of the world. And of course, that would also send a very strong message to China.
Now, it seems that the violence in the Middle East, it's been spiraling up and up in the recent months. There's been lots of casualties. And with every time when somebody is killed there, a leader is killed, I know, do all these recent events, the spiral of violence, and this has been the question that's been asked for months, how great is the risk of triggering an all-out regional war in the Middle East?
Of course, I don't know that. I wouldn't guess. I think the U.S., we've lost some influence in the region. I think in the past we would have been able to assert some sort of authority or influence to contain it. It doesn't feel like we have that same influence. Of course, yesterday was the 1 year anniversary of the Hamas attack on Israel, 7 October. Everybody's reminded of the horrific attack by Hamas. Hamas is a terrorist organization. They should all burn in hell. But tens of thousands of innocent Palestinians have also died. I think that the Israeli government has no interest in a peaceful outcome, only in destruction of Hamas, and they have allowed excessive use of force. And I think they run the risk of losing some support from the West by doing this. On the other hand, what they've done against Hezbollah has been much more has been very effective and has been more targeted. Still, there have been civilian casualties. None of those civilian casualties are okay or are acceptable. I think that the Israeli government obviously is going to have to respond, and they're going to hit Iran hard. There's a lot of speculation about what sort of targets they're going to hit, whether it's oil fields, the nuclear program, military bases, or some sort of combination. Now, my guess, and this is purely a guess, is that they're not going to go after the nuclear program yet. That's the next level of escalation. I imagine that there has been a lot of pressure from the U.S. and others not to hit Iran's oil fields because of concern about influencing the oil markets at this particular time. But there's plenty of military targets that Israel could hit with a real effect. So I imagine we'll know something over the next few days.
Are you worried that this can blow out of proportion?
Well, what I'm most worried about is the West failing to demonstrate political will to help Ukraine defeat Russia, help Israel defeat these terrorist organizations, and to defeat Iran, and for China to see that we lack that political will. That's what worries me the most.
General Ben Hodges, thank you much for your time.
All right, Kentus, thank you very much.